my talk will be about software engineering. I'm going to make a controversial statement. I'm going to make a call for higher levels of abstractions in the software that we are writing. The usual problem is that if you have a large software infrastructure, such as the Ansible toolkit, then you start with the best intentions. But after 5 years or so, you find that the software has become crusty, becomes very difficult to change. And of course, everybody wants to change it because you want to add more physics and you want to make it more efficient than modern hardware, modern CPUs, or you want to port to GPUs, etc. And my statement is that we need much higher levels of abstraction in our codes, and that we're not only make the codes easier to understand, it will also make them run faster. And the rest of my talk is a particular example of this statement. And the example I want to talk about is loop fusion. Loop fusion means that you have two loops that are run one after the other. As in my example, in the first line you multiply array by 2, in the second line you add 1 to an array. And as it so happens that these arrays are large, say they have different elements, then in modern hardware it's not just the arithmetic operations that cost time, but also the data movement from and to main memory. If you have large arrays, then each memory move is about 100 times more expensive than an arithmetic operation. So the time for these two loops is completely dominated by reading and writing from memory, and the actual arithmetic statements are just a perturbation on top of that. Obviously, if you merge these loops, then you don't need to write and read B, so the loops would run twice as fast. And at the bottom, I've written the same loops in C, as you write them down typically. It's just the same code. And now in the first half of my talk, I want to show you what exactly the compiler has to do to actually fuse these loops to make the code run twice as fast. So the first thing that the compiler does, quite surprisingly, is actually convert all the for loops and so on to go-tos and labels. You might think that this is something quite outdated, that people don't do this anymore. But it turns out that apart from many language-specific things, that defining all of the type of variable has and so on, that is the first thing the compiler does still today before the optimizer sees the code. And if you look at the large code here, I don't know whether you can see my mouse. I see if I highlight something on the screen. I'll try. You can. Beautiful. Here's, for example, initializing the loop. Here's the check whether the loop is finished. Then the actual body of the loop here. And then increasing the loop variable, going back to check one, that will be a loop here, and the other loop is on the right hand side. And this go-to soup of labels and go-to statements is called the control flow graph, and each of the little chunks here would be called a basic block. And this is the first thing that the compiler does. Next steps would be for the compiler to actually begin to optimize the code. There's a problem. If you look at this code, the first question that the compiler has to answer is, of course, where is the loop? How many loops are there? If everything there is just go-tos and labels, that's a different problem. I'm not going to go into any more details here, but to identify loops in the basic block graph, I cannot actually get a picture to start talking. But you have to identify this, you have to throw the graph theory a bit, you have to find the dominators, because every loop can have one entrance and multiple edges from every basic block in the body of the loop. You have to find back edges back to the entrance of the loop, and so on and so forth. And then after you have identified loops that you might want to merge, then you need to check whether the loops are compatible. You need to find out whether the iteration count can be determined ahead of time. If so, whether they have the same iteration count, whether they are compatible, whether the reading and writing the same arrays, whether the reading and writing in the same order, whether there are any other statements in between these two loops that need to move out, and so on and so forth. And it's quite complex, quite complicated optimization to perform. The infrastructure led optimization takes many thousands of lines of code. And this is loop fusion. Loop fusion has been around for more than 40 years. tools, the data structures, because it's way too difficult to do these things automatically. And then it's stuck and slow. We have to rewrite our applications every 5 years. No, that's not the only thing. But that is possible. I've been asking myself, is there a better way? And the statement I'm blocking it here, if the thought is yes, there is. We need to use much higher levels of abstractions, so high that they're not even available yet in C++. Okay, I promise for next year in C++. So this thought might be, I'm trying to do some kind of squad out here at the top. It's probably going to be one of the most low level and most high level talks in this session. So next I'm going to switch to abstract algebra. I assume most of you are physicists. If you're physicists, I assume you know what a group is. A group is a binary operation that is associative, it has a neutral element, and each element has an inverse. And the usual example is matrices, integer matrices. Matrices is really determinant. And in physics, groups are very important because we assume that microphysics is reversible, so at the low level, most physical laws are expressed with some kind of group theory, which you can perform at that point in time. There's also the notion of a monoid. A monoid is a binary operation, like a group, except it's not invertible, like a little sibling of a group. An example would be square matrices. You might not be able to invert that. And in computer science, monoids are much more important than groups, because if you think about, say, an assignment, x equals a, but that is not an invertible operation, because you lose the previous value of x. You all know monoids, they're called reduction operations. If you look at the ordinary D of Laplace and the I standard, except that here we use the mathematical language and we talk associativity. And if you look at, say, the A standard and the I standard, they don't use the word associative in there. But rather, they put the whole paragraph of English words in there saying the same thing, that behavior is not very fine if you can't change the order in which operations are performed. Now, this is about square matrices. What about if you have rectangular matrices? If you want to multiply rectangular matrices, then of course you can't always multiply them with each other. You need to have the right dimension. So in the bottom right corner, if you have an m by n matrix and an m by k matrix, multiply them, and the result is an n by k matrix. But they need to match up. The m's need to be the same. It's like when you play dominoes, you put tiles next to each other, they need to match. And that is an extension of a monoid called a category. Category is a binary operation, it's associative, it's a different element, but they also can call them these tags to identify which of these elements are compatible and which of these can be combined. And the categories were actually invented in the 1940s, quite some time ago, in the context of algebra and topology. So, of course, they use their own terminology for everything, so they don't call them tags, they call them objects, and they have arrows between the objects. So our matrices are then called arrows. So we have an arrow from M to N would be our N by M matrix. And that kind of makes sense, because if you take an N-dimensional vector and the matrix, the rectangular matrix would change into an N-dimensional vector. And matrix multiplication, N by M, N by K, N by K, and so on, works out the same way. And matrices are then arrows in a category where vector spaces are objects. Or in general, turns out that the functions which we program, are arrows in the category, the sets, so types of software engineering are objects. So I don't assume that as a physicist you have heard of categories, so you think they do sort of programming, but this is the kind of level of abstraction that I think we should be using in software engineering. And if you don't like it, well, I'm giving talk about these, I can't actually give you complaint. I'm really sorry about that. It would be nice to be able to discuss that. Now, categories is one thing. I want to introduce one more higher level of abstraction before I go on, and that is a mapping between categories, a functor. If it is a function has between set, each element of the domain is mapped to one element of the codomain, and if you map categories, you need to map both the objects and the arrows. So here, for example, I have on the left the domain, there is an object A and B, and an arrow F like, it's just what you expect. You have as input with a function, well, this is C++, it's a bit verbose, I apologize for that. You have a function f, which is an input, and the vector a, and then you define a new vector b with the same length as a, and then you loop over all elements and apply the function f to each element of a, and then you return the new vector b. This is how you would view a vector as a functor. And, if you remember how we started out, there are groups, and groups have laws, they're associative, there's an identity, and there's a neutral element. Vector spaces have laws, categories have laws, functors also have laws. And there are actually two functor laws, which I don't dare to derive here. And if you map the identity function, you get the identity function. And if you map a function g after you map a function f, then you can also do the mapping in one step, g after f. And if I had a blackboard here, I could also show you on the functor graph that I showed you earlier. And the interpretation of these two functor laws for a vector would be that empty loops can be eliminated, and that adjacent loops can be fused next to each other. And it is quite surprising to me that you have something as abstract as categories, as functors, and if you look for what happens in C++, out comes a very low-level, very important optimization that you can directly apply. But there seems to be something there. Functors isn't just some fancy mathematical thing. And to prove the point, the things like functors can be defined in language called Haskell. I'm not going to go into any details here. But part of the Haskell source code are these rules. These are essentially patterns that the compiler applies when compiling. And these are rules that both by the directory author. And one of these rules is called map identity, and this is the identity function that is something that lambda x goes to x. And if you map the identity function, you don't do anything, and you map f, and then map g is the same as mapping f after g, so the dot here is function composition. So it turns out that these loop optimizations that used to be more than 10,000 lines of code, but in this compiler, you can do it in a single line of code. This is not for arrays, this is for lists, but it is a simple thing. And I believe this kind of level of abstraction will allow us to write much better code. Now, who cares about functors and loop fusion, of course, but there's much more that we need to do. So one thing is that you could have loops over multiple containers simultaneously, kind of adding or multiplying two containers. That would be called a monomedial function in categories. You can have nested data structure, container inside a container. You have a AMR hierarchy, range level, consists of boxes, and each box contains the same vector, and so on and so forth. With categories, there's function composition, functions can be distributive. Reversible, if you think about stencil operation, it turns out to be called a co-model enzyme. So basically, everything that is there in numerical physics has an equivalent there. And at first, it seems to be quite surprising that abstract topology has anything to do with numerical calculations, but it actually isn't so. There's something called the Curry-Hauer-Lambeck correspondence, and that means that the same kind of mathematics was discovered essentially three times independently, three different contexts, three different terminologies that are used. And these are one hand Lambda calculus. Lambda calculus is the theory of functions that if you think about our problem verb or the proof or etc., you want to think about Lambda calculus. The second is constructive logic, and the third would be category theories. So every statement that you make in terms of Lambda calculus, in terms of programs and types, can translate into category theory context. I think this is a very useful language. The disadvantage of what I'm suggesting here is, of course, that abstractions need time and motivation to learn. It's like, I don't know, when you were introduced to vector spaces and what that means to me was undergraduate physics. In high school, I learned what a vector is, what a vector has two different components. And we add vectors, we add components, etc., and so on. And at the university, you then learned that now vector space is anything where you can add things, and addition is associative, commutative, and so on. And suddenly, many things that approach that Kant had, unfortunately, is that there are mainstream languages are too valuable. So these concepts like category or vector space or functor, and it's basically impossible to define such a concept in today's languages. It might be possible in C++ in the future with concepts of C++ strategy, so there'll be nothing out for that. The syntax is a bit verbose, and Haskell, the other language I mentioned, it's definitely possible, but Haskell is probably not the, what I would call the mainstream language today. There's two numeric packages, and to close with a bit of literature. If you're interested in categories, there's a gentle introduction, it's an online book, Category Theory for Computing Science. That might be interesting to read. And if you're a C++ programmer, then Roger Spilevsky has a website, Category Theory for Programmers, and he has a series of blogs that also have been turned into a book that you can have. And there are these archive articles. So this is a growing field. Your programming has the connection to Category Theory. Good articles on the archive, for example, that you're on bias, relativists, or natural bias. So then, I want to close the presentation and see whether you have any questions.
Hello. So my question is, I think you raised a very important point. The situation is even worse if you think about exascale computing, meaning running codes in massive amounts of codes. The reason why I say this is not only loop fusion, which is just a simple example, but all the optimization done by the compiler, not only that, but the data manipulation as well of running the codes. So my question is, have you thought about backward model, how to tackle this problem, and in particular, can you think about using something like OpenCL or some other language that can define some sort of standard memory model approach for data manipulation?
Okay. Good. No feedback anymore. When you program not to know
thank Eric for
so far.
I don't know, Steven, are you, think you're ready to start?
Yeah.